Today we are going to start with zeroth law of thermodynamics. It states if two systems are in thermal equilibrium with the third system, they are also in thermal equilibrium with each other. In the simple way, if two people are friendly with the third person, so they will become friends with each other also. With the help of diagram, we are explaining this phenomena. Here, Y is in thermal equilibrium with X as well as Z. Therefore, X and Z are also in thermal equilibrium with each other. On this diagram, we can see that A is in thermal equilibrium with B and C is also in thermal equilibrium with A. So, B and C also are in thermal equilibrium. That is the meaning of zeroth law of thermodynamics. Next, we are taking Born-Haber cycle. What is the use of Born-Haber cycle? Here we will be studying all the processes involved in the formation of sodium chloride solid. There are many steps in the formation of any ionic solid, and the first step is that the sodium solid will change to sodium gas. And energy required to convert sodium solid to sodium gas is called sublimation energy. And delta H of sublimation is equal to 108.4 kilojoules per mole. This is the first step in the formation of sodium chloride from sodium solid and chlorine gas. Second step is that sodium atom in gaseous state will lose one electron and form sodium ion in gaseous state, and the energy required for this process is called ionization enthalpy. And the value of ionization enthalpy of sodium is 496 kilojoules per mole. And this is endothermic process because energy will be required to remove the electron from sodium gaseous atom. The third step is now we have to break the bond between Cl2. For breaking the bond between Cl2, we require bond dissociation energy. But we need only one chlorine atom. Therefore, we have to use half mole of chlorine. So, for one mole of chlorine, bond dissociation energy is 242 kilojoules per mole. For half into bond energy, if you want to find out, it will be 242 divided by 2, that is 121 kilojoules per mole energy will be required to break the bond between half mole of Cl2. Cl-Cl bond is to be broken in half mole, so 121 kilojoules per mole energy will be required. The fourth step is this chlorine atom which we have got in gaseous state will gain one electron to form chloride ion. And when electron is gained, energy is released. And this energy released is called electron gain enthalpy. The value of chlorine electron gain enthalpy is highest in case of chlorine. This is equal to minus 348.6 kilojoules per mole. This is an exothermic process because this energy is released. Now, this all the processes we are showing with the help of diagram. Here, first sodium gas is getting converted to sodium ion. Then it is combining with half mole of chlorine. So half mole of chlorine means bond dissociation energy. We are applying 121 kilojoules. So we get sodium ion plus chlorine gaseous. Now in the second step, chlorine gaseous will gain one electron to form chloride ion. And here exothermic process we have 342 kilojoules per mole energy will be released. Now we have sodium ion and chloride ion. They will combine together to form crystal lattice. And when they form crystal lattice, when crystal lattice is formed, energy is released. This energy is called lattice energy. And if you want to break the crystal lattice, then energy will be required. That will be also equal to lattice energy, but opposite in sign. Now, here sodium solid plus half chlorine gas changes to sodium chloride solid. So the energy of formation of sodium chloride from sodium solid plus half Cl2 gas is minus 411.2 kilojoules per mole. So the formation of NaCl solid is an exothermic process because energy is being released. Next step, now sodium ion plus chloride ion form crystal lattice to form sodium chloride solid. So lattice energy we can calculate, which is equal to 411.2 plus 108.4 plus 121 plus 496 minus 348.6, means this involves all the types of energies, and delta H lattice comes out to be 788 kilojoules. For NaCl solid, sodium ion plus chloride ion gas decomposition, we will require this much energy. If we want to find out delta H solution, then it will be delta H lattice plus delta H hydration. Now, hydration energy is exothermic mostly. For 1 mole of NaCl solid, lattice enthalpy is plus 788 kilojoules per mole. Hydration enthalpy is minus 784 kilojoules per mole, and so delta H of solution will be equal to plus 788 kilojoules per mole minus 784 kilojoules per mole. So delta H will be plus 4 kilojoules per mole. It means dissolution of NaCl is accompanied by very little heat change. It's an endothermic process, but very little energy is involved in this process. Next question we are going to take up, calculate the delta G of reaction for conversion of oxygen to ozone, that is 3O2 gas changes to O3 at 298 Kelvin, and if Kp for this conversion is 2.47 into 10 to the power minus 29, we have to calculate delta G. The first step is to write correct formula. Delta G of reaction is equal to minus 2.303 RT log Kp. R is equal to 8.314 joules per Kelvin per mole. Let us substitute the values. Delta G is equal to minus 2.303 into 8.314 joules per Kelvin per mole into temperature 298 Kelvin into log 2.47 into 10 to the power minus 29. On calculation, we will get 163,000 joules per mole, that is 163 kilojoules per mole. Now, delta G is positive, it means the process is non-spontaneous. If delta G is negative, process is spontaneous at 298 Kelvin. So, this process is non-spontaneous at 298 Kelvin because delta G comes out to be positive. Next question, find out the value of equilibrium constant for the following reaction. 2 ammonia gas plus carbon dioxide gas give NH2CONH2, this is urea solution, plus water is formed. Standard Gibbs energy change, that is delta G standard at given temperature, is minus 13.6 kilojoules per mole. So here delta G is given to us and we have to find out the equilibrium constant. So formula is the same. Log K will be equal to minus delta G of the reaction divided by 2.303 RT. Now, because R we are taking in joules, so delta G should be converted into joules. Kilojoules to joule means multiply it with 1000, that is 10 to the power 3. So here we get delta G minus 13.6 into 10 to the power 3 joules per mole divided by 2.303 into 8.314 into 298 Kelvin. Log K comes out to be 2.38. You have to see anti-log. Anti-log you have to see of 0.38. It will come out to be 2.4. Means you can write the decimal after first place, so you will get 2.4. And whatever 2 is here, that will become 10 to the power 2. So the value of K comes out to be 2.4 into 10 to the power 2, which is the value of equilibrium constant. Here, equilibrium constant value is quite high. It means reaction is going in forward direction. If value of K is high, it means reaction is going in forward direction. If value of K is low, it means reaction is going in backward direction. Next question we are taking, at 60 degrees centigrade, dinitrogen tetraoxide, that is N2O4, is 50% dissociated. Calculate the standard free energy change at this temperature and at 1 atmosphere. So first we write the equation, N2O4 gives you 2NO2 gas. Now if N2O4 is 50% dissociated, the mole fraction of each substance we will calculate. Mole fraction of N2O4 will be 1 minus 0.5. How we have 1 was initially there? Initially N2O4 was 1 and NO2 was 0. And because it is 50% dissociated, so it will be 1 minus 0.5, and this will be 0.5, 2 into 0.5, because it is 2 moles of NO2. So the mole fraction of N2O4 will be equal to 1 minus 0.5 divided by total number of moles, that is 1 plus 0.5. Why we have taken 1 plus 0.5? Because final number of moles are equal to 1.5. Similarly, we find out mole fraction of NO2. This will be twice of 0.5. Why twice? Because coefficient of NO2 is 2. And divide by total number of moles, that is 1.5. So partial pressure of N2O4 will be equal to mole fraction of N2O4 into total pressure. So 0.5 divided by 1.5 into 1 atmosphere. Partial pressure of NO2 will be equal to mole fraction of NO2 into total pressure. So 1 over 1.5 into 1 atmosphere. We have to find out Kp. Kp is equal to partial pressure of NO2 raised to the power 2 divided by partial pressure of N2O4. This we will also study in the next chapter, chemical equilibrium. Now substituting the value, we will get 1.5 divided by 1.5 whole square into 0.5. On calculation, the answer comes out to be 1.33 atmosphere. Delta G standard will be equal to minus 2.303 RT log Kp. Delta G will be equal to minus 8.314 joules Kelvin per mole into temperature 333 Kelvin into 2.303 into log of 1.33, which is value of Kp. It will come out to be 0.1239. So the value of delta G comes out to be minus 763.8 kilojoules per mole. Since delta G is negative, therefore reaction is spontaneous. Next question we are going to take up. For the reaction at 298 Kelvin, 2A plus B gives you C. Delta H is equal to 400 kilojoules per mole. And delta S is equal to 0.2 kilojoules per Kelvin per mole. At what temperature will the reaction become spontaneous, considering delta H and delta S to be constant over the temperature range? So first thing is, we will calculate the temperature at which the reaction will be in equilibrium. And at equilibrium, delta G is equal to zero. So the formula delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. This is Gibbs-Helmholtz equation. We have substituted delta G is equal to zero. So we get delta H minus T delta S equal to zero. Our temperature will be equal to 400 kilojoules per mole divided by 0.2 kilojoules per Kelvin per mole. Be careful, the units of both should be same. Delta H and delta S should be in same unit, either in kilojoules or in joules. On calculation, we get 2000 Kelvin. So 2000 Kelvin is the temperature at which reaction will be in equilibrium. Now above 2000 Kelvin, if we keep the temperature more than 2000 Kelvin, delta G will become negative. So reaction will become spontaneous above 2000 Kelvin. And below 2000 Kelvin, reaction will be non-spontaneous. At 2000 Kelvin, reaction will be in equilibrium.